William Morrow and Harper Audio present Pay Dirt, a V.I. Warshawski novel by Sara Paretsky. Performed by Susan Ericksen. For Eve, part of my beating heart. 1. Nightmare. Gunshot. When you hear it, you know it's not a backfire, not an M80. Sprint up the stairs. Peter shoves past me into the room. I grab his arm. You can't go in there blind. You don't know who's shooting, who they're shooting at. He shoves me aside and plunges into the room. A second shot. A third. Screams. I follow him in. Blood. Brain. Bone. I slip in them. The air. Acrid. Thick with smoke. I can't see who's alive, who's injured, who has weapons. Stumble on Peter lying across Taylor's body, bellowing, "No! No!" The cry woke me. I was weeping. I reached for the lamp switch, hand finding empty air. I was in a strange place, alone. Panic hit me. Taylor's mother had kidnapped me. I'd been jumped in a Chicago alley. I was in a KGB prison. I tried leaping out of bed, but the sheets were knotted around me like a mummy's tapes, and I landed on the floor. And finally remembered I was in Kansas. Lawrence. Not in a dump in Chicago's uptown, where Taylor Constanza had been murdered by their father. Taylor had died 5 months ago, but the nightmares wouldn't release their grip on me. It was my own thrashing that had knotted up the sheets. I extricated myself, remade the bed. My sleep shirt was soaked through with sweat. I took it off, washed myself off in the B&B's small bathroom, put on a t-shirt. It was only 3 a.m. I tried to go back to sleep. I'd driven down to Lawrence to see Angela Creedy join an elite group of basketball players who'd broken the 3,000-point lifetime scoring marker. She was a star on Northwestern University's team, a star attracting international attention. She was also a housemate of Bernadine Fouchard, Bernie to me, who was a hockey player and my sort of goddaughter. Angela and her Northwestern Wildcats had beaten the hometown Jayhawks in last night's game, but it had been close, exciting to watch. Dozens of girls in Kansas regalia had crowded around Angela when she left the visitors' dressing room, thrusting their programs at her. She'd squatted with easy grace to their head level and signed their programs, chatting in a way that left the girls starstruck. When the crowd thinned, she joined me and Bernie in the hall, along with their other roommates. Angela and Bernie were close, so I'd grown close to her as well. The three other women I knew only in passing. Angela embraced me. "Vic, I know it wasn't easy for you to come, but thank you. It means so much to have you here, especially since my mom couldn't make it. We're going downtown to celebrate. Come along, won't you please?" Angela's mother was a nurse in Shreveport. Her rare days off were spent caring for her own aging mother and soaking her swollen feet in a eucalyptus bath.
"Yes, Vic, you should come," Bernie said. "We are going to a place called the Lion's Heart. Everyone on the team will be there."
"Thanks, babe, but the night belongs to Angela and your friends. I'll find some tamer form of entertainment. Bernie Fouchard grabbed my arm as I moved away from the group.
Vic, you cannot go back to your room alone. When you are alone, you...
She flung her hands up, trying to think in English, but gave it up.
Bruit du noir. You must be with other people.
I could guess the meaning. My smile tightened. Bernie, don't pretend to know what I need or not. I'll be happier alone than in a noisy bar with drunk students. She put both hands on my arm.
Vic, I only want you to be well, not to insult you.
I pulled away roughly. You persuaded me to join you in Kansas. I'm glad I came. Glad I got to see Angela in triumph. But that's my limit. Join your friends. Have a good time. But not so riotous you can't be safe on the road tomorrow. Text me when you get back to Evanston. She looked at me for a long moment, her expression disconsolate. But she finally joined the group around Angela. I had an impulse to cross over to her to apologize, but they left before I acted. I'd driven to Lawrence by myself, needing privacy from the high-octane energy of 5 NCAA athletes, needing privacy, most of all, from Bernie's insistent hammering at me. When you fall, when you're injured, you get back on the ice immédiatement. She'd pressured me into coming down to watch Angela, which was probably a good thing, but she couldn't stop at one good thing. She relied on me as an example of women's strength. She needed me to be who I was last September, not who I'd become since Peter's and my incident. Peter Sanson was an archaeologist and director of a famed institute at the University of Chicago. He was my lover, and I was in love with him, which had not happened to me in many years. This made the incident harder to overcome. Taylor Constanza had been one of his second-year students. Taylor disappeared the week the fall term began. The parents were frantic, threatening to sue the university for dereliction of fiduciary responsibility and threatening Peter in more ominous language. Taylor was a trans femme who'd been on a month-long dig with Peter and 5 other students in August. The parents were claiming Peter had coerced their son into a sex change to fulfill his sexual fantasies. It was a sickening scenario. When the police came up empty, I agreed to look. Sadly enough, Taylor had been easy to find. They were sheltering with other runaways in an uptown fire trap. Taylor pleaded with me to keep the location secret. They were frightened of their parents, who'd reacted violently when they came out after the August dig. I'd promised, but Peter felt he needed to let the school and the parents know that Taylor was safe, but needed time away from both. The parents were furious with me and with the university, which in turn pressured both Peter and me to reveal the address. When we wouldn't, the parents hired another detective who easily followed the same trail as me. This second investigator ignored Taylor's plea for safety. The next day, I got a terrified text from the student. Their father had shown up with a gun. By the time an ambulance arrived, father and child were both dead. Afterward, Peter suffered in every way. One of the bullets had winged him. He needed multiple surgeries to recover from damage to his shoulder, and the pain was unrelenting. He was also awash in guilt. Even though I'd told him the student was afraid of their parents, he'd felt he had to let Mrs. Constanza know I'd found her child. Peter had a high sense of responsibility to his students. He felt he'd let Taylor down badly. The university didn't make his life easier. Their lawyers deposed him along with everyone else on the August dig, hoping to prove Peter had never touched Taylor. Peter knew he shouldn't blame me, but he did. If I hadn't been a detective, skilled at finding the hidden, he would have left matters to the university. He could have kept himself three removes from the carnage. I knew I needed to cut him slack, but I'd been the one who stayed to comfort the other runaways in the apartment. I was the one who answered hours of cop questions at Area 2 while I still had bits of bone and brain on my clothes. I was also the one who spent hours on the phone with the dead student's mother. My own nerves were sheared to the root. I'd hung up on her and ignored the university's demands that I make myself endlessly available to lawyers, both Mrs. Constanza's and the university's. Peter and I wore each other out. We fought, made up, fought again. Peter had always been a steady person, not prone to furies. If we argued, he could almost maddeningly see my side as well as his own. Now it horrified him to see how easily he gave way to anger. Finally, exhausted by his demons, he decamped to Malaga, Spain, where he was helping excavate a 3,000-year-old Phoenician settlement on the shores of the Mediterranean. It was a relief for both of us when I dropped him off at O'Hare's shortly before Christmas. It was after he left that the nightmares began. Sometimes, like tonight, I'd reenact the moment of Taylor's murder. Other times, I'd have dreams about my mother. Gabriella had died of ovarian cancer when I was in my teens. I was an only child, born after numerous miscarriages. She was fierce in her love for me, but she pushed me also to be independent, to stand up for myself, not to settle for second best. Her loss left a hole that no other love ever completely filled. Gabriella had been an immigrant in a neighborhood with many immigrants, but she'd also been a Jew in a neighborhood without them. The physical battles I'd fought on South Chicago's playgrounds to defend her from the insults the local kids liked to chant distressed both her and my father. Now, in my current nightmares, she was under attack, and I was helpless to protect her. After Taylor's murder, I started second-guessing my work decisions, forgot important meetings, left invoices unsent. I began retreating from my friends, taking long runs up the lakefront with the dogs, even avoiding my elderly downstairs neighbor. He was 1,000% in my court, but his constant fulminations against Peter wore on me. "I thought he was better than those losers you usually bring around, but he's just as bad as that Murray Ryerson, only thinking of hisself." It was Bernie Fouchard who forced open a crack in my shell, or rather, Bernie's mother, Arlette. Bernie herself had driven me to fury with her badgering me on getting back on the ice after a bad fall. "People depend on you. Everyone is hurting in their lives. Not only you, but only you can help people who are in trouble. I'm not a superhero, and I'm not a robot. Trauma shatters me the way it does everyone. So take your platitudes and your naivete back to the hockey arena." She looked shocked and hurt, but she mercifully shut up and disappeared. In January, though, her mother flew to Chicago with the Canadians. Her husband had been my cousin Boom Boom's closest friend when the two of them played for the Blackhawks. Boom Boom was Bernie's godfather, And when he died, he more or less bequeathed the godparenting to me. Arlette Fouchard pushed past me into my apartment. Bernadine has been telling me your troubles. Bernie thinks I'm made of titanium, not flesh and bone. She wants me to be something non-human. She and everyone else. Clients, friends, strangers who contacted me online, either wanting to know how to protect their trans children or vilifying me for brainwashing a boy into thinking he was a girl, using language whose ferocity and obscenities were terrifying. Bernadine is not subtle.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.